Hello, I'm Dr. Payal Dande. Welcome to the learning episode of B.Pharm on the unit called Classification and General Treatment of Alkaloids and Glycosides under the section of Pharmacognosy and Phytochemistry 2 of Semester 3 under B.Pharm course. Before we start, let's first have a look onto our contents and the learning objectives. In this unit, we are going to first have an introduction to alkaloids and glycosides, the two important type of chemical compounds that are present in the plants, and further we'll learn about their classification, isolation procedures, physicochemical properties and chemical tests used for their identification. So let us quickly have a look onto our modules. Module 1 will talk about the introduction to alkaloids. Module 2, we are going to study the classification of alkaloids. In module 3, we are going to talk about the physicochemical properties and chemical test of alkaloids. While in our module 4, we are going to look upon the isolation procedures of alkaloids. Further, we will move to glycosides in our module 5, where we are going to have a short introduction. Module 6, we are going to talk about the different classification methods that are available for glycosides. In module 7, we are going to talk about the physicochemical properties as well as the chemical tests that are used for glycosides. And finally, in module 8, we are going to see the isolation procedures of glycosides. So let us move on to our module 1, which talks about the introduction to alkaloids. Chemically, alkaloids are the nitrogen-containing organic compounds. The nitrogen is usually present in the heterocyclic ring, and thus they can be called as heterogeneous group of natural substances that are found in more than 150 different plant families. Based on their diversified structure, they exhibit wide range of biological actions on human beings as well as in animals. Besides this, they are also important for the chemical significance, taxonomical classification and biogenetic studies. Let us talk about its history. Carl Friedrich Wilhelm Menster was a German pharmacist who discovered the name alkaloids in 1819. However, the name is believed to be originated from a Latin name alkali, which in turn arised from an Arabic word al-kalvi, which means ashes of plants. Due to their toxic nature, they were mainly used as poison and others were used for the hallucinogenic properties. Their probable functions in the plant is to prevent it from being grazed by the herbivorous animals. Later, humans started using it as medicine, and the first isolation of alkaloid called as narcotine was made by Derosin in 1803. After this, there was no looking back. Several scientists contributed and isolated the series of alkaloids like morphine, emetine, colchicine, strychnine, brucine, piperine, caffeine, quinine, cinchonine, conine, papaverine and so on. By 1844, we were able to get about 25 alkaloids which were isolated from the cinchona bark alone. But in 1870, a landmark in the domain of alkaloids was achieved by determining the structure of conine, which was also becoming the first synthesized alkaloid in 1889. From the beginning of 19th century till date, research is still initiated to discover new alkaloids from the plants as well as animals. With the advancement of sophisticated analytical technologies, the structure characterization of new alkaloids had reached to more than 3000. At present, we have been able to discover 6000 alkaloids from natural resources. Okay, let us look at its complete definition. Alkaloids can be defined as the organic compounds of natural or synthetic origin, which are basic in nature and contain one or more nitrogen atoms, normally of heterocyclic nature, and they possess specific physiological action on human or animal body when used in small quantities. There are few deviations from the definition. Let us see those exceptions. First, we said that they are basic compound. Some of the alkaloids are not basic, for example, colchicine, piperine and quaternary alkaloids. Similarly, we said that they contain nitrogen. The nitrogen in some alkaloid is not in a heterocyclic ring, for example, ephedrine, colchicine, mescaline. Similarly, we said that they come from the plant origin. Not true. Some alkaloids are derived from bacteria, fungi, insects, frogs, and animals. Now let us see about their occurrence and distribution in the environment. The number of alkaloids which are discovered from plant has been continuously increasing. It is noted that alkaloids are taxonomic importance. It is noted that alkaloids are of taxonomic importance. Their distribution in nature appears to be restricted or specific. In general, the major distribution of alkaloids occurs in the angiosperm, but their presence is also detected in microorganisms, marine organisms, insects, animals, and some of the lower plants. It has been reported that among the bacteria, about 47% species indicate the presence of alkaloid. In the lower plants, although the alkaloids are found in less number, some important sources are ergot fungus, giving peptide alkaloids, ergometrine, ergotamine, and so on. Alkaloids are more frequently found in the dicot than monocots. They are rarely found in lower plants. The families which contains alkaloids are Apocynaceae, Rubiaceae, Solanaceae, and Papaveraceae. These are just few to talk about. The alkaloidal content, however, they are rarely seen in families like Rosaceae and Labiatae. Now let us see the different forms of alkaloids that are present. Alkaloids are present in several forms in the plants. They are present as free bases, as the salt of organic acids, as the salt of inorganic acids, and also as the salt with special acids. Some of them are even present in glycosidic form, and they are known as glycoalkaloids. Now let us also talk about their functions. The functions of alkaloids can be seen in plants as well as in animals. So first we will see the functions of alkaloids in plants. The exact role of alkaloid is not known, but it is believed that they may act as a protective against insects and herbivores due to their bitterness and toxicity. In some cases, they are formed as the final product of detoxification. They may become the alternative source of nitrogen in case of nitrogen deficiency. Occasionally, they also act as the growth regulators in certain metabolic systems. They may even be utilized as a source of energy in case of deficiency in carbon dioxide assimilation. So these were the different functions which are done by the alkaloids in plants. Now let us see their role in medicines. The alkaloids are poisonous in nature, but when used in small quantities, they can exert useful physiological effects on animals as well as on human beings. Hence, they have secured a very significant place in medicines. Now let us see the nomenclature of alkaloids, meaning how are they named? Generally, the name of alkaloids end by the word I-N-E. This is in the suffix. These names may refer the genus of the plant. For example, let's say alkaloids atropine is named after the genus Atropa from the plant Atropa belladonna. And it ends up with I-N-E, as you have seen, atropine, which contains I-N-E at the end. Some of them are based on the plant species name. Let's say cocaine, coming from the erythroxylon cocoa, once again it's ending up with I-N-E. It may be a name which is based on the common name of the drug. The example for this is ergotamine from ergot, which is a common name for sclerotium of claviceps purpurea. Sometimes they are even named with the name of the discoverer of that alkaloids. For example, pelleterine, that was discovered by Pelletier. Similarly, a few alkaloids are named on the basis of physiological actions, such as emetine, that act as an emetic, which causes vomiting. And interestingly, few names are based on the prominent physical character of an alkaloid. For example, hygrine. This name was given because of its hygroscopic nature. Now that you have understood the nomenclature of alkaloids, we will also see the importance of prefixes and suffixes in the overall name. The prefixes such as nor designates N-demethylation or N-demethoxylation. For example, norzudoephedrine or nornicotine. Similarly, the prefix apo such designates Similarly, the prefix apo designates dehydration. For example, apomorphine. The prefix iso, zodo or neo and even epi indicates different types of isomers. Now let us see how the suffixes are added and what do they mean. Suffixes such as dine, that is dine, designates isomerism as cunidine and synconidine. Similarly, the next suffix is nin, that is nine, which indicates in case of ergot alkaloids, a lower pharmacological activity is seen, to which you have the name which is ending up with nine. So, one example is ergotaminine, which is less potent than ergotamine. Okay, now that we have understood completely about the nomenclature, the prefixes as well as the suffixes, in our module 2, we are going to talk about the classification of alkaloids. There are various methods which are proposed for the classification of alkaloids and which are as follows, and it is given on your screen. The first one is biogenetic or biosynthetic classification. As the name suggests, it is based on the biogenetic or biosynthetic pathway that forms the alkaloid in the plants. The second classification is based on taxonomy. This classification is based on the botanical source of an alkaloid. The third classification is pharmacological classification, which is based on the pharmacological activity. And the fourth is the chemical classification. This is based on the basic chemical skeleton or chemical structure of alkaloid. Now, let us see each one of them in complete detail. Let us first start with the biosynthetic classification. This method gives importance to the precursors from which the alkaloids are biosynthesized in the plant. Hence, the variety of alkaloids with different taxonomic distribution and physiological activities can be brought under the same group. The alkaloidal drugs are categorized on the fact whether they are derived from amino acid precursors as ornithine, lysine, tyrosine, phenylalanine and tryptophan. Now let us see a few examples of this type of classification of alkaloids. All alkaloids that are derived from tryptophan are termed as indole alkaloids. Those which are derived from lysine are known as piperidine alkaloids. The alkaloids that are derived from ornithine are classified as pyrrolidine alkaloids, while the one that are derived from histidine are grouped as imidazole alkaloid. I hope you understood this. Now let us move on. This is quite convenient and logical way to group together the alkaloids which are derived from the same precursor but possessing different taxonomic distribution as well as different pharmacological activities. This type of classification is followed in some of the standard textbooks. Now let us go for the second one, which is taxonomic classification. This particular classification essentially deals with the taxa, that is the taxonomic category. This method of classification is based on the distribution of alkaloid in various plant families. Some of them are also grouped as per the name of the genus in which they occur. For example, ephedra, cinchona, these are some of the examples which contains the different alkaloids within that genus. This can be further classified as per their chemotaxonomic characters. Let us see some example of taxonomic classification. Some example of plant families and the various species which are associated with them are stated below. See, cannabinaceous alkaloids, in which the example is cannabis sativa. Similarly, we have rubaceous alkaloids where we have the example like cinchona, which contains quinine, and the other yohimbe species are also included in this. Then the third we have solanaceous alkaloids. Here we have all the plants which come under solanaceae family and they contain the alkaloids. Example, Atropa belladonna, Capsicum annuum, Datura candida, etc. Now let us move to the third type of classification, which is known as pharmacological classification. Under this classification, a broad range of various specific pharmacological characteristics are exhibited. Depending on the pharmacological activity that is exerted, the alkaloids are classified under various categories like analgesic, antispasmodic, expectorant, antimalarial, etc. Perhaps this is the most important type of classification for the pharmacist like us. However, such a classification is common and broadly known as health. However, such classification are only common and broadly known to healthcare profession. Let's see few examples of the same. Morphine as narcotic analgesic, quinine as antimalarial, strychnine as reflex excitability, lobelin as respiratory stimulant, boldine as choleretic and laxatives, aconitine which is used in neuralgia, pilocarpine as anti-glaucoma agent and ergonovine as oxytocin. So these are some of the examples, and there are many which are there shown on your screen, and you can go through it, and this is the way we normally classify with respect to their pharmacological activities. But there is a limitation to this type of classification. This method does not take into account the chemical nature of crude drugs. Similarly, there are more than one alkaloids that may be present in the same drug, and each alkaloid may exhibit different pharmacological action. For example, morphine is narcotic analgesic, while codeine from the same plant exert antitussive action. There is one more example. Let us see, in cinchona, quinine is antimalarial in action, while quinidine is cardiac depressant. Now let's come to the fourth type, that is chemical classification. Well, this is the most established form and widely accepted way of classifying alkaloids. It classifies the different alkaloids based on the presence of the basic heterocyclic nucleus, that is the chemical entity. The alkaloids are broadly categorized into two divisions. First one is known as heterocyclic alkaloids. They are also known as true alkaloids. They are divided into 12 groups according to the nature of their heterocyclic ring. And the second one is non-heterocyclic alkaloid. They are known as protoalkaloid, also known as biological amines, and sometimes known as pseudoalkaloid. Now let us see the differences between them. True alkaloids are normally present in plants as salts of organic acids. These contain nitrogen in the heterocyclic ring, which is derived from the amino acid and always basic in nature. These alkaloids are toxic in nature too. For example, morphine, codeine are some of the important example of true alkaloids. Now let us come to the next, that is protoalkaloids, or which are also known as amino alkaloids. These are simple amines in which the nitrogen is not there in the heterocyclic ring. Sometimes they are considered as biological amines. These are basic in nature and prepared in plants from amino acid. The examples are mescaline, hodinine, ephedrine and colchicine. Now let's go to the third term, that is known as pseudoalkaloids. This includes mainly steroidal and terpenoidal alkaloids and purines. They are not derived from amino acid, hence they do not show many of the typical characters of alkaloids, but gives the standard qualitative test for alkaloids. The example of pseudoalkaloids are colchicine and caffeine. Next, the table shown on your screen indicates the types of alkaloids and their occurrence in various plants along with the basic chemical ring. Do go through it in detail, and then you can understand each one as per their chemical structure. The first one is pyrrole and pyrrolidine alkaloid, and the examples are given over there. Examples are hygrine and coca species. The structure is shown on your screen. Similarly, pyridine and pipyridine alkaloids, the example is lobelin. The third, pyrrolizidine alkaloid, where the example is synthionine. Then we have tropine alkaloids, example is atropine. The fifth is quinoline alkaloids, the example is quinine. Then we have isoquinoline alkaloids, the example over here is morphine. Eporphine alkaloids, the example is boldine. Indole alkaloids, where the example is ergometrine. Similarly, we have on the ninth position imidazole alkaloids, the example is pilocarpine. The tenth is phenanthrene alkaloids, where once again we have the example of morphine. 11th, we have diazocine or norlupinane type of alkaloids, which are also known as quinolizidine, and the example is lupinin. 12th, from here we have the proto, pseudo and so on, this type of alkaloids. From 12th, we have now the proto, pseudo as well as amino alkaloids. Let us see them. First is purine alkaloid, where the example is caffeine. The 13th one is steroidal alkaloid, which means the example is solanidine, which comes from ashwagandha and kurchi. Then we have amino alkaloids, where the example is ephedrine, and the last diterpene alkaloids, where we have the example aconitine. Okay, having learned about the chemical classification, now let's move on to the module 3, where we are going to see the physicochemical properties of alkaloids. Let us first start with the physical properties. Alkaloids are generally colorless, crystalline solids with a sharp melting point or decomposition range with few exceptions. Let us see those exceptions. Some alkaloids are amorphous gums, while others like conine, spartine, nicotine, etc. are liquid or volatile in nature. Similarly, some alkaloids can even be colorful. For example, betanidine is red, berberine is yellow, and the salt of sanguinarene are copper red in color. The solubility of the alkaloids and their salt is useful in pharmaceutical industry for the extraction and formulation of the final pharmaceutical preparations. In general, the free bases of alkaloids are soluble in organic, non-polar, immiscible solvents. But the salts of most alkaloids are soluble in water. Both alkaloidal base and their salts are soluble in alcohol. However, over here, once again, we have few exceptions. Let us see them. First, quinine monosulfate, that is the salt of quinine, and those are insoluble in water. Similarly, salt soluble in organic solvents, we have lobelin and epoetropine, hydrochloride, those are soluble in chloroform. So, this is an exception. So, in contrast, the bases are soluble in organic solvents and they are insoluble in water. Once again, we have few exceptions. The alkaloid containing quaternary bases are only water soluble, while some of the pseudo alkaloids are proto alkaloids shows higher solubility in water. For example, colchicine, they are soluble in alkaline water, even in the acid, and caffeine is freely soluble in water. Similarly, we have caffeine, ephedrine, codeine and pilocarpine that are soluble in water. There are few bases that are insoluble or sparingly soluble in certain organic solvents. Example, morphine is insoluble in ether, while theobromine and theophylline. Another important difference is in the racemic form. There are some racemic forms which are optically inactive and they are found to be pharmacologically active in alkaloids. Let us see them. For example, racemic form of atropine, which is known as DL-atropine, is physiologically active. Now, this is generally not seen. Now, after completing the physical properties, we will move on to our chemical properties of alkaloids. The alkaloids may contain one or more number of nitrogen and it may exist in the form of primary, example mescaline, then we have secondary amine, where the example is ephedrine. They can even be present in the form of tertiary amine and the example is atropine. Some of them are present as quaternary ammonium compounds, for example tubercurarine chloride. In the last type, their properties vary from other alkaloids owing to the quaternary nature of nitrogen. In the natural form, the alkaloids exist either in free state as amine or as salt with acids or alkaloids and even NH oxides. Most of the alkaloids are basic in reaction due to their availability of the lone pair of electrons on nitrogen. The basic characters of the alkaloidal compounds are enhanced if the adjacent functional group are electron releasing. The alkaloids turn to be neutral or acidic when the adjacent functional group are electron withdrawing. For example, amide group, which reduces the availability of the lone pair of electrons. But alkaloids exhibiting basic characters are very much sensitive to decomposition and cause a problem during their storage. Their salt formation with an inorganic acid prevents their decomposition. According to the basicity, the alkaloids are classified as weak bases, strong bases, amphoteric, and as well as neutral alkaloids. The example of the same are shown on your screen. Most alkaloids contain oxygen and are solid in nature, for example, atropine. But some alkaloids are free from oxygen and are mostly liquids, for example, nicotine and conine. Alkaloids get decomposed by heat except strychnine and caffeine. On reaction with acids, some get hydrolyzed and some alkaloids may form salts. The concentrated acid may either dehydrate the alkaloids or lead to demethoxylation. Alkalis have different effects on different types of alkaloids. For example, dilute alkalis may lead to liberation of most alkaloids from their salts. They may cause isomerization of alkaloids or can form salts with alkaloids containing a carboxylic group. Strong alkalis such as aqueous sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide form salts with the phenolic alkaloids, and some causes hydrolysis of ester and amide alkaloids. They can even cause opening of a lactone ring in the alkaloids. Now let's discuss about the chemical tests which are generally being utilized in order to identify the presence of alkaloids in plants. There are some important qualitative chemical tests that are used for the detection of alkaloids. They are based on the characters of alkaloids that can give precipitation as salts of organic acids or with compounds of heavy metals like mercury, gold, platinum, etc. The different reagents which are used are as follows. Please see on your screen the Mayer's reagent, which is basically potassium mercuric iodide solution. Reacts with the alkaloid and gives cream color precipitate. In the second reaction, the Dredgendorf's reagent is used, which is basically potassium bismuth iodide solution. It reacts with the alkaloids in the plant extract and gives red precipitate. Similarly, we have Wagner's reagent, which is chemically iodine potassium iodide solution. They are also called as complex, which yields reddish brown precipitate while reacting with the alkaloids. Some alkaloids give yellow color precipitate with picric acid, and this test is called as Hager's test. Similarly, different alkaloids give buff or other colored precipitate with tannic acid. So these important 5 tests are generally used for detection of alkaloids in plant extract. However, the chemical tests with heavy metals are not solely limited to the alkaloids. There are proteins, coumarins and pyrons which can also give the precipitate with these reagents. So for this purpose, the specific tests for individual alkaloids are more important for qualitative evaluation of crude drugs. It may be also noted that some alkaloids do not give such tests, like caffeine, which is highly water soluble, will not give such type of test. So having known about the chemical test, so after understanding the generalized chemical tests that are used and the various specific tests that are available, now let us discuss in our module 4 about the general isolation and extraction procedures of alkaloids. The extraction of alkaloid is based on their basic character and solubility pattern. The normal procedures followed are to treat the moistened drug with alkali so as to set free the bases as it exists in the salt form, and then to separate free bases with organic solvents. This is known as Tass-Otto process. Though the method of extraction vary generally, following procedure is applied for small scale extraction of alkaloids. First, the plant is defatted with petroleum ether, especially in case of seed and leaf forms of drug. Before applying this treatment, the alkaloid should be tested for its solubility in petroleum ether. Otherwise, the drug should be pre-treated with acid to convert alkaloids into their salts. In the second stage, the drug may be extracted with a polar solvent like water, ethanol, methanol, aqueous alcohol, or mixture of the alcohol and water with acidified aqueous solutions too. By this treatment, the alkaloid salts are transferred to polar solvents. It also helps in removing the pigments, sugars, and other organic secondary constituents. In the following stage, the alcoholic solution is evaporated to thick syrup and is subjected to partition between aqueous acid solution as well as the organic solvent. After continuous extraction with the organic solvents for some time, the aqueous phase is made alkaline with either sodium carbonate or ammonia. The basic aqueous solution is then extracted with the convenient organic solvent, followed by drying of alkaloid containing the solution, normally with sodium sulfate, finally filtered and evaporated to yield the alkaloid residues. Let us see one more method which is given in the standard textbooks. The other method is meant for the extraction of alkaloid that employs the treatment of drug with the ammonia so as to convert the alkaloid salts into their free bases. Such liberated alkaloids in free bases forms are conveniently extracted with the organic solvents like ether, benzene, chloroform, etc. The method is not useful for isolating alkaloids with quaternary nitrogens. The further purification of crude extract of alkaloid is done by the various ways. However, it may vary with the individual alkaloid. Okay, let us see the important ways which are known to us in order to go for further purification. The first one is direct crystallization for solvent. It is very simple method of isolation and may not be useful in case of complete mixtures. Second, we have steam distillation, where this method is specially employed for volatile liquid alkaloids like conine, spartane and nicotine. But otherwise, this process is not suitable for alkaloids with higher molecular weights. The third, we have chromatographic techniques, the various chromatographic techniques that are available. This method has proved to be ideal for the separation of a vast number of plant alkaloids. The different techniques of chromatography, such as thin layer chromatography, column chromatography, gas chromatography, liquid chromatography, ion exchange chromatography, high performance thin layer chromatography, are all used for the separation of individual alkaloids from complex mixtures. The fourth technique involves gradient pH. Over here, though alkaloids are basic in nature, there are variations in the extent of basicity of various alkaloids of the same plant. Now, depending on this character, the crude alkaloid mixture is dissolved in 2% tartaric acid solution and extracted with benzene so that the first fraction contains neutral or very weak basic alkaloids. pH of the aqueous solution is increased gradually by 0.5% increment up to pH 9, and the extraction is carried out of each pH level with organic solvents. By this way, the alkaloids with different basicity are extracted. Strongly basic alkaloids are extracted at the end. Dear friends, I hope you have got a reasonable understanding about what do we mean by alkaloids, also about their nature, function and role in plants and animals. Similarly, you may have got a detailed understanding of its classification, physicochemical properties, as well as chemical tests that are used to identify the different alkaloids. If you have missed any of the module or content, then you may log on to our website called www.cec.nic.in to download videos, FAQs, LORs and other contents so that you can stay updated with this chapter. Now, let's move ahead to our next module on glycosides. Let us start our module 5 with the introduction to glycosides. To start with, let's first understand the definition of glycosides. Glycosides are organic compounds from plants and animal sources which on acid or either enzymatic hydrolysis give one or more sugar moieties, which is known as glycon. Along with this, it also gives non-sugar moiety, that is known as aglycon, or sometimes it is also known as genin. Generally, the two are attached with a glycosidic bond that is formed with the loss of water molecule. They are considered as the condensation product of sugars. Thus, they form either acetyls or sugar ethers by interaction of hydroxyl group and hydrogen from sugar and non-sugar moiety. The sugar molecule present in the glycoside may be one or more than one. Similarly, it may include same type such as beta D glucose or different sugar moieties such as rhamnose, mannose, galactose, digitoxose, etc. Sometimes it also involves uronic acid such as glucouronic acid. Now let us go to our module 6, where we are going to talk about the classification of glycosides. Glycosides can be classified in several ways. They are classified based on their chemical nature of a glycan moiety, the therapeutic significance based on the presence of sugar or a glycan, and also on the basis of linkage across the glycan and a glycan part. Let us first start with the classification of glycoside, which is based on the a glycan moiety. Let us first see the classification of glycoside based on the a glycan moiety. According to the chemical nature of a glycan moiety, there are following types of glycosides, say around 11 to 12 types of glycosides. First one is known as anthraquinone glycoside. It is based upon the a glycan, that is the a glycan moiety over here would be an anthraquinone molecule. Second, sterol or cardiac glycosides, where the a glycan part is steroidal in nature. Third, we have saponin glycosides, where the steroidal moiety, where there are two moieties, one is triterpenoid, the other is steroid. Fourth, we are having bitter glycosides. Fifth, we have coumarin glycoside. Then we have cyanogenetic glycoside, flavonoid glycoside, isothiocyanoid glycosides, aldehyde glycosides, phenol glycosides, and steroidal glycoalkaloids. So these are the several important groups which are being classified based on the a glycan structure. The second type of classification of glycoside is based on the glycan moiety. Over here, the glycosides are classified based on the sugar or the glycan which is present in their structure. Sugar and glycoside are of different types, but mainly it is beta D glucose. Other sugars which are present could be galactose, fucose, mannose, rhamnose, digitoxose, saccharose, and so on. So based on the sugar moiety, they are known as, let's say if the sugar moiety is present as glucose, they are known as glucoside. If the sugar moiety present is rhamnose, they are known as rhamnosides. If the sugar moiety which is present is pentose type, then they are known as pentoside, for example ribose. And in few cases, the sugar present is digitoxose or saccharose type, as we have seen in the digitalis. The next classification, that is the third type of classification of glycoside, is based on the basis of the linkage between the glycan and the a-glycan moiety. They are as follows. We have four types. First is known as O-glycoside. In such type of glycoside, the anomeric carbon of sugar part is linked with the alcoholic or phenolic or sometimes hydroxyl or carboxyl group. As shown on your screen, the example is given. We have senosides, which are the example of O-glycoside. Now coming to the second, that is S-glycoside. In such type of glycoside, the anomeric carbon of sugar moiety is attached to a sulfur atom of a glycan. They are also known as thioglycoside. One of the important example is sinigreen, which comes from black mustard. The third type is N-glycoside. In such type of glycosides, the anomeric carbon of sugar is linked with the nitrogen atom of amino group or of a glycan, like in nucleosides, for example DNA and RNA. They are more appropriately known as glucosamines, and they are not seen in plants. The fourth type is the most common one, which is known as C-glycosides. In such glycosides, the sugar is linked or condensed directly to carbon atom of a glycan. The anthraquinone glycosides from LO, known as barboline, and the example are the major example of C-glycoside. The fourth type of classification is based on the therapeutic activity. Now this becomes important to pharmacists like us. It is based on the pharmacological effect that is exerted by the glycoside. And the general examples are, for example, cardiac glycoside, where we have digoxin or digoxygenin, the laxative and purgative glycoside, where we have senosides A and B from senna leaves, the anti-inflammatory glycoside, where we have example as salicine, which comes from the willow bark, The fourth type is anti-ulcer glycoside, where we have example of glycyrrhizine coming from licorice root. The fifth are the bitter glycosides, where we have quercetin from quercia wood, which are used as bitters. And the sixth type could be local irritant glycosides, where we have the example as sinigrine from black mustard seeds, which act as a local irritant. There could be several such examples. We have just taken few to understand them. Now, let us move on to our module 7, where we can talk about the physicochemical characteristics of glycosides. In general, glycosides are amorphous or crystalline substances which are soluble in alcohol and water, but insoluble in the inorganic solvents such as chloroform or ether. They are named on the basis of source and may end up with the word IN. Let us see the example: sinigrine, digoxin, salicine. However, the systematic name is formed by changing the suffix to OSE from OSE to OSID, that is oside. They are named on the basis of source and may end up with IN, that is in. Few examples are sinigrine, digoxin, salicine, etc. However, the systematic name is formed by the changing suffix of O's to oside. For example, senoside, cascaroside are few of the important example of systematic naming. They are usually accompanied by hydrolytic enzymes in plants. As such, glycoside gets easily hydrolyzed by the acids, alkali, and as well as enzymes. The erglycon moiety, which is separated after hydrolysis, is nonpolar in nature, and thus they get solubilized now in nonpolar solvents like chloroform, benzene, ether, etc. They are optically active and generally they are levorotatory in nature. Although glycosides contain sugar moiety, however, the physical, chemical and therapeutic significance is based on the erglycon part. In order to exert physiological effect, the glycosides have to get hydrolyzed. Sugar in glycoside only helps in the absorption and further facilitates the erglycon part to reach the site of action. They are believed to be involved in regulating growth and protecting the plant. Now, let us see the important chemical test which is used in order to identify the presence of glycoside in plants. Presence of glycoside is tested using the general Fehling solution test, which is using the Fehling solution A and B. They give the test positive only after they are hydrolyzed using mineral acids. However, there are specific tests to further identify the type of glycosides. For example, saponin glycoside, cardiac glycoside and so on. Now, let us move on to our module 8, where we are going to talk about the methods of isolation or extraction of glycosides from plant. The general method by which the glycoside is extracted and isolated is termed as TAS-OTO method. In this method, a fine powder of the plant drug containing glycoside is made powdered and then extracted using a suitable solvent with the appropriate method of extraction. As glycosides are polar in nature, alcohol or water are the most preferable solvent which are used for its extraction. Care needs to be taken to keep the extraction temperature below 45 degrees centigrade while extracting the thermolabile glycosides. The extract is further treated with the lead acetate to precipitate tannins and further filtered. The excess of lead is precipitated in the form of lead sulfide by passing hydrogen sulfide gas over the filtrate. The filtered extract is now concentrated to get the crude glycosides. The filtrate is further subjected to fractional solubility, crystallization, distillation to get some of the pure glycosides. These are further purified or separated and isolated using various chromatographic techniques which are available. The isolated and purified glycosides are then characterized using advanced analytical instruments such as infrared spectrophotometer, UV visible spectrophotometer, NMR as well as the mass spectroscopy, which also are very important in characterizing a particular glycoside. To conclude our present discussion, let us first recall whatever we have studied in this learning episode. We learned about the alkaloids and glycosides. We also saw their physicochemical characteristics, their chemical test, isolation procedures, and the various modes which are used to classify them. We said that alkaloids are the organic compounds of natural or synthetic origin, which are basic in nature. They contain one or more nitrogen atoms, which are normally heterocyclic in nature and possesses specific physiological action on human or animal body when used in small quantities. Alkaloids are more frequently found in the dicot than monocot. They are rarely found in the lower plants. They are classified based on the biosynthetic precursor, taxonomy, pharmacological effect, and chemical classification. The physicochemical characteristics of alkaloid was based on their nature, color, stability, solubility, decomposition, and the effect of acids as well as alkalis on the alkaloids. The general isolation of alkaloid is done using the Stas-Otto method. Similarly, we said glycosides are organic compounds from plants and animal sources, which on acid or either enzymatic hydrolysis give one or more sugar moiety, that is known as glycon, along with the non-sugar moiety, which is known as erglycon or genin. They are classified based on the chemical nature of erglycon, the therapeutic significance, the presence of sugar or glycon moiety, and also on the basis of linkage between the glycon and the erglycon part. The physicochemical characteristics of glycoside were based on their nature, color, stability, solubility, decomposition, and the effect of acids. Presence of glycoside is tested using Felling solution test. They give the test positive only after they are hydrolyzed using the mineral acid. However, there are specific tests to further identify the type of glycosides. I am sure it was interesting to know about alkaloids and glycoside, the two major chemical compounds with the extensive therapeutic significance and the diversified pharmacological activities. With all the above information, now we come to an end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind that we discussed today and recall whenever you get time. It's now for you the time to do your self-study. With all the above information, now we have come to an end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. It's time for you all to do some self-study. This is Dr. Payal Dande signing off. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website for MCQs, quizzes, LORs at www.cec.nic.in. Till then, keep studying. Goodbye and stay connected with us.